Hello everybody, this is Johns Hopkins with Baltimore Heritage, and I'm here with another of our 5 Minute Histories videos, and today you might have to turn your volume up a little bit. I'm here on the 200 block of South Durham Street to talk about the Billie Holiday House, and I'm here at what the sailors might call first light. And it's pretty early, and I don't want to wake these good folks up. Durham Street is an alley street, and I'm basically in their front yard, so I'm going to talk a little bit softer than usual. But before getting to Billie Holiday, I thought that I would talk about alley streets. For those of you who don't know, streets like Durham and Castle and Dallas Street and Sarah Ann Street in West Baltimore. So I went to look up the definition of alley street, and since I don't have all 28 volumes of the Oxford English Dictionary, I went online this morning and looked up the Merriam-Webster's Dictionary. They did not have a definition of alley street, making me think, maybe that's a Baltimore thing. They did have a definition of alley, so let me read you that. The first definition in Merriam-Webster's is a garden or park walk bordered by trees or bushes. Clearly not here. Second definition, a grassed enclosure for bowling or skittles. What planet are they from, or what era are they from? Skittles? Really? All right, third definition, a narrow street, especially a thoroughfare through the middle of a block, giving access to the rear or lots of buildings. Well, that's pretty close, but we are not here on the rears of buildings. We're here on the fronts of buildings. And these kind folks' front yards. So I'm going to go with the definition that my friend Eddie Leon from the City's Preservation Commission told me years ago, that when it rains on a street, the water flows to the outside edges and runs down the outside. And on an alley, the water flows to the middle and runs down the middle of the street. So, Eddie, if that definition is actually true, fabulous. If it's not, I'm still sticking with you. All right, let's talk about Billie Holiday. She was born in 1915, and the origins of her birth are a little mysterious. For many years, people thought she was born in Baltimore, but several years ago, folks discovered some birth records in Philadelphia. And it seems that her mother, Sadie Fagan, lived here in Baltimore, but went to Philadelphia for whatever reason to give birth. And she did give birth to a daughter named Eleonora Fagan, and then she came back to Baltimore pretty quickly. So even though maybe she technically didn't arrive on planet Earth here, I think we've got good claim that she is ours. She lived here on this 200 block of South Durham at 219, the Billie Holiday House, and spent her young years, although they were probably troubled years. Her mother moved around a lot, so she lived in various relatives and friends' houses. We know that she had run-ins with the truancy officer, for skipping school. It was here at a very young age, 10, 11, that she started singing publicly in the whiskey joints and brothels in Fells Point, here now called Upper Fells Point, the Upper Fells Point neighborhood. And in a horrible scene on Christmas Eve in 1926, so young Eleonora would have been 11 years old, her mother came home on Christmas Eve to find her being raped by one of the boarders. That man went to jail, but obviously a traumatic experience for everybody. Somewhere around there, we know that Eleonora was sent to essentially reform school. She was kind of a hard-to-handle child. And when she got out, her mother moved from 219 South Durham, exactly one house away, to 217. So this block on South Durham Street can claim Billie Holiday at least twice, maybe more. So shortly after they moved, her mother starts a restaurant on Argyle Avenue, which sadly has been demolished, but she starts a restaurant in the 1920s just off of Pennsylvania Avenue, which was getting into its heyday as a nightclub spot and a jazz spot and a music scene. And we know that young Eleonora at ages 13, 14, started singing in bigger venues on Pennsylvania Avenue. Maybe not the big ones yet, but she was starting to come into her own. Her mother, the restaurant doesn't work. Her mother moves to Harlem, not Harlem Park, Baltimore, but Harlem, New York. And at age 14 or so, Eleonora moves up there, never to call Baltimore home again. However, on Pennsylvania Avenue, there is a statue to her. It was commissioned in 1970, or the thought was begun in 1971. And in 1977, we kind of got our act together, and we commissioned an artist, James Early Reed, University of Maryland sculpting professor. And he starts out, there's some disputes over the who's paying for the rising cost of materials, and the statue isn't erected and unveiled until 1985, and unfortunately the acrimony was so great that Mr. Reed was not even there for the unveiling. Maybe if this is a tortoise and the hare race, the tortoise wins, because in 2009, so a number of years later, the statue originally had been erected, a wonderful statue, on a kind of a really crummy little base, because we didn't have enough money to pay for a proper base. But in 2009, we in the city of Baltimore came up with the money and erected a new base. Mr. Reed was there for that unveiling. And so now there's a wonderful statue on a proper base on Pennsylvania Avenue. When Eleonora moves to New York, she starts singing in Harlem venues, even bigger than what we had in Baltimore. And by the age of 18, records her first jazz album professionally.
I'm just out of the frying pan, right into the fire. Well, I lost me a cheating man, and got a no-count lie. Swipe the old one for the new one, now the new one's breaking my heart. I jumped out of the frying pan right into the fire. Lord, right into the fire.
Somewhere in there, she decides that Eleonora Fagan is not the name that she wants to go by. She decides to take a name from a famous silent movie actress, Billie Dove. So she takes the first name Billie and then uses her father's last name, Holiday. Her father was never really much a part of her life, but that's what she chose. And then, of course, Billie Holiday goes on to become one of the jazz greats. Maybe her most well-known song, of course, is Strange Fruit, lynching and Jim Crow in the South. So let's get back to the 200 block of South Durham. The folks here, around the time of the 100th anniversary of her birth, so 2015, looked around and said that they didn't think that we were celebrating Billie Holiday as much as we should, that she's a superstar and we weren't doing that much. So they took it upon themselves with the Upper Fells Point Neighborhood Association and a group called the Baltimore Billie Holiday Project to try to change that and rectify that. And that they did. And let me read you a few things that they've done and they continue to do. They've got a great Facebook page. We'll put that up. But they've commissioned painted screens that are here on this 200 block of South Durham Street with Billie Holiday themes. They've got artists to do murals. They have a ceramics artist who's done a wonderful ceramics piece here. They even got an artist to work with school kids to do a mural of gardenias. That was the famous flower, the flower that Billie Holiday made famous by putting in her hair all the time. They have block parties. They put in Belgian block little diamonds in front of the houses that Billie Holiday was known to live at. And so they've done a really wonderful job of making this block, the Billie Holiday block, included in addition to just the Billie Holiday house. So I'm going to end by inviting you to come on down here, even in the COVID-19 times, and walk along this art-studded block and think about Billie Holiday and think about the neighbors who have really helped elevate her legacy here in Baltimore. Thanks so much, and we'll see you next time.
For the crow.